Now here's your host, Bill Teegins.
Hi, everybody. Welcome to the Eddie Sutton Show. A great week for the Oklahoma State Cowboys as they wrap up the Big 8 tournament with the championship, only the second in school history. And, Coach, what a great way to get ready for the NCAA tournament, but what a great three-day run for the Cowboys.
It was a marvelous weekend for our basketball team and for all the great fans that followed us to Kansas City. And that was a beautiful sight holding up that trophy.
It sure was.
I think that our players took turns carrying it around like a baby. They really took good care of it. But our team really played well, Bill, in all three games. I think the one thing that really stood out was our defense. We held all three of those ball clubs under 40% shooting from the field. And at the same time, I felt like some of our players really grew in that now they better understand their roles. And we had guys that stepped forward and played well at the offensive end. I think they always play well defensively, but when you get Pierce and Owens and Roberts and Scare and Collins, those guys scoring points for you, it really takes a lot of pressure off of Bryant Reeves and Randy Rutherford.
That's really a tough stretch, though, when you play three games in 3 days. That's tougher than even the NCAA.
Well, it's much more tougher than the NCAA because you're there, you got a day in between, and you only play two games. When you play three games in a row like we did, it's very exhausting. And when we got home Sunday evening, we had a bunch of tired soldiers. But we had a great group of students and fans to greet us. We had about 1,000 people there waiting for us. And I think that really thrilled some of our young players. I don't think they had ever seen that before. And yes, the first day we got back, well, we practiced very lightly and to try to get our legs back because I think that's going to be very important this weekend.
Well, again, it was a great run in Kansas City. When we come back, we'll take a look at the Nebraska and Oklahoma games when the Eddie Sutton Show continues. Welcome back to the Eddie Sutton Show. Let's go to Kansas City. Great basketball to show you. Coach, your first matchup with the Nebraska Cornhuskers.
Well, we had played very well against Nebraska in the two regular season games, and we played well in this ball game as well. They jumped out early. They came out of that dressing room, and Danny Nee had really given them an inspirational speech, and they got us down in double figures. But our guys held their poise. They just went to work at both ends of the floor, and we were behind 24-17, and we went on a streak, and we hit 22 straight points before Nebraska scored again, and that was really the ball game. We went into halftime with a 14-point lead and just continued to build on it. As I mentioned, we held them to a very low percentage from the field, 28%. We out-rebounded them in the ball game. The only thing, I guess, that we didn't do very well, we turned it over 17 times. Randy Rutherford led us in scoring with 20 points. Bryant only scored 13, but he only took 10 shots. Scott Pierce played great. He had 14 rebounds and 10 rebounds and 14 points, a double-double. And he's a guy that really has stepped up, and there's another one, Keonte Roberts. Keonte, in a broken four like that, if you can get him the basketball, he's terrific at finishing the shot.
Tom and I had named Scott Pierce as our player of the game on the radio for this game. He did play a tremendous game. Great transition right there.
Beautiful two-on-one break, and got called. They called for a foul, and Randy converted for a three-point play.
You know, you talked about poise. Here you are at halftime, but you talked about poise a moment ago. Every game, each one of these three games, there were knockout times when you guys could have folded, but each time your poise factor ended up being a key thing.
That's seniors. You know, we have four outstanding seniors, and when you have that type of leadership, when somebody gets momentum, you want to curtail it as quickly as you can, and when you have the momentum, you want to make that run last for a long time. But our players don't panic. When somebody is on a roll, you know, they just stick to business, and that defense finally wears on people, and I think that's the area that most people came out of Kansas City, and I'm talking about the sports writers, the sportscasters, our fans, opponents, they just thought our defense was terrific, and I agree with them. That was the big thing. And there's breakaway by Keonte Roberts.
Keontae was 6 in that game, and you win it by a score of 68-48, a big win over Nebraska. And again, you don't have much time to think about things because the next day, there you get Oklahoma again.
Well, when you go into a tournament, you try to prepare, and of course, at this late in the year, you should have been able to have faced everything. So then it's a matter of just trying to really emphasize these are the things that we must do to beat the University of Oklahoma. We felt like the biggest keys would be don't give up a lot of trays and don't put them on the free throw line. The two best free throw shooting ball clubs that we faced all year is the University of Oklahoma and Iowa State. And in the game in Stillwater when we beat Oklahoma, they only got 22 points if you take the three-point shots and the free throws. When we were beaten in Norman in overtime, they got 62 points. They hit a lot of trays and they knocked down 29 free throws. So that was one of our goals, and in this ball game here, we accomplished that because they only scored 22 points from the line. They had 14 from the line, and they had 2 3-pointers. And that's why we were able to defeat Oklahoma 74-58.
Well, the game plan was great. Bryant Reeves really had a great game.
Well, we were able to get the ball into him much better than we had the day before and maybe the last two or three games in the Big 8 regular season. But you got to understand, it's hard to get the ball into a guy if there's two or three defenders around him. And the other teams have been willing to make sacrifices by letting other players open. And I think that's where our ball club has matured because our people now step forward with confidence and they knock down those shots. In this game right here, Jason Scare stepped up and hit 2 threes when Oklahoma didn't cover him. But Bryant did have a great game, 12 rebounds, 28 points. And he was the only one. No, Terry Collins had 10 points. The only one that was in double figures was Bryant, but Terry had 10. He's got a very, very soft shot. Bryant, if you get the ball to him down low, good things are going to happen because he's not selfish. He'll kick it off to a player like Pierce who hit that basket.
Pierce got a nice shot from out there, doesn't he? Here's Jason in one of his trays.
Well, Pierce and Jason and Andre, all three of them are really good outside shooters. I think that Andre and Jason might have a little better range than Scott, but all three of them have to takes a little bit of time to get their shot off. But if you let them get set, they're outstanding shooters.
Again, you're up by two at half, 36-34. We're into the second half
now. Oklahoma made a run at us just before halftime, and then I told our players, I said, you guys got to understand that when you play the University of Oklahoma, it's a special game. Not only are we playing for the Big 8 tourney title and for a high seed in the NCAA, there are a lot of people in this state that take great pride in Oklahoma State and Oklahoma, and that's why they call it the Bedlam Series. And our players went out at the beginning of the second half and hit 10 straight points. And from that point on, well, Oklahoma's playing catch-up.
Nice jump shot right there, Terry Collins. Boy, he hit some big shots over the weekend.
Terry's the most improved player that we have from the time the season began to right now. He really has worked hard, and I just look back now, and our staff talked about this the other day. I wish we had redshirted him as a freshman because he really didn't play that much. But a year from now, he could be a terrific player. He is now, and he is one of the reasons why we're 23-9 going into the NCAA tournament. And I think I might tell the people who are watching, you know, we had to pre-record this because we had to go to Baltimore, and we played Drexel on Thursday night, and hopefully we'll be playing Saturday afternoon. And some of the people may see this just before the game because that's a 12 o'clock tip-off, and we'll be playing either the University of Pennsylvania or
Alabama.
Two tough teams, but we're not overlooking Drexel because anybody gets the NCAA is a good team or they wouldn't be there.
Great time of year, great victory here. Kelvin Sampson and Eddie Sutton talking it over. 74-58, the Cowboys victorious again. And we're going to take a break. When we come back, we'll take a look at the championship game and more on that great championship week in Kansas City when the Eddie Sutton Show continues. Welcome back to the Eddie Sutton Show, the third game in 3 days for Oklahoma State, but it was the championship game against Iowa State.
Iowa State is a very talented team and played exceptionally well early in the year, then hit a midseason skid, and a lot of people would have because they had to go to Lawrence and Columbia and Norman 3 games in a row. But they recovered and came back, and the last game of the regular season beat Nebraska, came in, and I think a lot of people thought they had to win their first game, which they were able to do over Missouri. In the semifinal game, they played great against the University of Kansas and upset them in overtime. And we knew that they had a chance to win the conference tournament for the first time. They have six seniors, and we knew it was going to be a war, and it truly was. I don't believe I've ever seen an Iowa State team play any harder, any tougher than they did in this ball game. But our guys, they too are tough, and they responded, and we jumped out. But just Iowa State never gave up, and they kept making runs at us. It was Brian Reeves showing his ability to shoot down shots out on the perimeter rather than always getting them underneath the basket. There's a good example of what we did. We forced turnovers, and then we displayed patience by coming down here, giving the offense a chance to go inside to Bryant, and he was named the MVP and certainly should have been given that honor because he had a terrific game.
And Randy Rutherford was on the all-tournament
team. Randy Rutherford
team.
Made the all-tournament team as well, along with, I think, Miner and...
Lauren Meyer.
Meyer and
Beecham.
Yeah. Two from Iowa State, two from Oklahoma State, and the outstanding player from Oklahoma, Ryan Miner.
You know, you think about Iowa State, and they did have a great run in this tournament. They scored 15 points in the first half against Missouri in their opening game, came back and won that one.
I think it scored 51 or 53, yeah, 53 in the second half against the Tigers.
That's amazing.
Iowa State will be playing the NCAA tournament. I think they drew a tough one in Florida in that Florida, I didn't think they'd even get in, but they got in, and they got also the advantage of playing in Florida. I think they're playing that game in Tallahassee.
Right.
Five teams out of the Big Eight go to the NCAA, and two teams go to the NIT, the University of Nebraska and the University of Colorado.
A great 7-of-8 in postseason. Here you are at halftime. You're up by a 31-23 score, and got to feel pretty good the way things are going here.
Well, I felt good because I felt like we'd really played well and had control of the game, and there's a nice move by Brian Reeves. But they made a terrific run at us there in the second half, and this is a good example of composure and toughness because when you got down that last 10 minutes, I knew our team was fatigued. And I told them on a timeout, I said, you're going to have to check your valentines, your heart and your belly and see what you're made of. And I kind of urged them on it and challenged them, and boy, they responded. They came out, and when they had cut the lead to 2 points, there's our defense again, and a great shot by Andre Owens. He just took it hard to the basket and followed strongly. And there's Hoiberg, their great perimeter shooter.
Boy,
here's a play that's very – Jerry Petro, you can see he goes in there and he signals it's offensive basket interference. And the scorekeeper thought that the call had been on the defense, but even – so he gave them 2 points. All of a sudden, we go down to Randy Rutherford, hits a three, and I look up, and it's 52-48. And I said, hey, the score should have been 52-46, and we had quite a controversy over that. And finally, I convinced Stanley Reynolds and to go over and talk to Petro, and they got the scorekeeper straightened out. And that was, you know, I think a lot of people noticed it, but nobody knew for sure what had happened.
On the radio, we were discussing that, too. Bryant with another great performance, 20 points in this one.
We hit free throws down the stretch, and this will be a key when you get into NCAA play. Can you hit those free throws, and especially late in the game when teams are going to come after you and foul you like Hoiberg fouled on that play. And there's Terry Collins hitting two free throws. And we blew away from him. You can see 60-51. There's Mika Leek, their outstanding senior from, I guess he's from...
Slovakia.
Yeah, I always forget which one, where he's from, but he's an outstanding player. He and Hoiberg and Meyer, in my opinion, will all play basketball somewhere next year. It may be in Europe. I'm not sure all of them play in the NBA, but they're really fine basketball players. They've been a credit to Iowa State, just like our seniors have been a credit to Oklahoma State.
62-53, the final, and as you know, that was a great week in Kansas City, and we want to give you a special look at that. Wade Pearson and Tom Dorado in our off-the-court feature this week. Relive that championship week in Kansas City.
Up to the sky. nervous, they may cause you tears. Go ahead, release your fears. Stand up and be counted. Don't be ashamed to cry. You gotta be bad. You gotta be bold. You gotta be wiser. You gotta be hard. You gotta be tough. You gotta be stronger. You gotta be cool. You gotta be calm. You gotta stay together. All I know, all I know, love will save the day. Herald what your mother said. Read the books your father read. Trying to solve the puzzles in your own sweet time. Some may have more cash than you. Others take a different view.
Another great feature by Tom Dorato and Wade Pearson. They've done some outstanding work this year. You know, the people that go to Kansas City from all the schools just have a marvelous time. It's a bowl atmosphere. And we had the largest number of people from Oklahoma to ever come to Kansas City. And it was really exciting for them. And you saw me holding that net up. And the players and the coaches talking about this, that's what makes all that hard work worthwhile, when all of a sudden you attain one of the goals that you set out to accomplish before the season began. And I just can't heap enough praise on our assistant coaches and our four seniors and the rest of the players. That was a special moment, and it was my 59th birthday.
Yes.
And the crowd sang happy birthday to me, and you might have noticed when Bryant Reeves came off, he put his arms around me and whispered in my ear, and he said, happy birthday, Coach. He said, I told you we're going to win this one for you.
That's great. Another great feature and a great week. Also, thanks to Greg Blackwood, who had some of the video shot of that one. When we come back, we'll take a look at what's ahead for the Cowboys when the Eddie Sutton Show continues. Welcome back to the Eddie Sutton Show. Again, we are pre-recording this, but the NCAA Tournament is upon us. You're glad that you're headed back out east.
Well, I would like to be a little closer to our campus so our fans could have attended, but I knew we weren't going to be in the Midwest because I knew Kansas was going to get that, or I thought they were going to get that number one seed. I didn't think they'd send us to the southeast, but I thought we'd either go east or west. Well, if you go west, altitude's a problem. You go to Salt Lake City, and we get a taste of that every year when we go to Boulder. And I don't like that. Plus, there's a 2 hours time difference if you get to the regional, because that's being played in Oakland. So going east, we had a great experience there a few years ago.
Sure,
because we went to the University of Maryland, which isn't very far from where we're going to be. Won two games there, went on to the Meadowlands, and our fans might remember that was when Corey Williams had his toe on the line, and we would have won the game. Instead, it went into overtime, and they beat us in overtime to knock us out of the Sweet 16. This year, we're going to Baltimore, and we'll be playing there, hopefully, for two games. And if we win, we go back to the Meadowlands again. And let's take a look at the East bracket. Wake Forest beat North Carolina to get the number one seed. Everybody thought North Carolina would get that. They play NCAA, and these are all in Baltimore. Minnesota plays St. Louis. And, of course, Alabama and Penn, and there's our game, and the winners play on Saturday afternoon at 12 o'clock. Up in Albany, the University of Tulsa takes on the University of Illinois. Villanova, a team that's very hot right now, plays Old Dominion. North Carolina, Charlotte, they won their league. They didn't win their conference tournament. They play Stanford. And the University of Massachusetts, who I think is one of the best teams in the country, takes on St. Peter's.
That's a pretty good region right there.
And the winners, of course, advance to the Meadowlands the following week. You know, going east also gives us a tremendous opportunity to have our young men get a little culture, get a little history. When we went there the last time, you know, we went over to Congress and toured Washington, D.C., and we're going to do that again. And if we win on Thursday night, and hopefully we do, well, then on Friday we've got to set up. We're going to Washington, D.C., and let our guys learn a little bit about our country. And they're going to get a chance to go to the White House, which is going to be a great experience for them.
You've had so many teams in the NCAA tournament. How do you prepare? Is there anything you do different when it comes to this time of the year?
Well, there's no tomorrow. You know, once you lose, you pack up your bags and you come home and put them away until next season. But I don't think you do anything different. I think you try to refine what you've been doing. You might put in a couple of out-of-bounds plays or something like that. But if you've been successful, you better stay with it. I think the biggest thing in our case is that we've got to make darn sure that our legs are fresh. And that's why we've had to lighten up our practice sessions, because when you play three games in a row, three mm-hmm. tough games, it emotionally drains you, physically it drains you. So we want to go into the tournament fresh, looking forward to it. And, you know, I don't think you have to motivate players. I think they know that, hey, this is for real. This is the big show. This is the big dance. This is the greatest sporting event in our country. And by winning two games this week, hey, you go to the Sweet 16. If you win two more, you're in the Final Four in Seattle.
It's a great time of year, and defense a great equalizer. Coach, good luck to you. It's going to be a fun week again for the Cowboys. For Coach Sutton, I'm Bill Teegins. We'll see you next week on the Eddie Sutton Show. So long, everybody.